It's that time of the year again. You guys remember this mess? You may have seen it in previous years. Well, it is time to put it back into service, see if it still works, and add on to it, because you always add on and expand, right? This is my homemade Christmas lights, outdoor Christmas lights thing. It is basically a bunch of these kind of WS2812, well, they're 2811. You can, I think, see the chip through there. I think you can see the little 8-bit WS2811 chip in there. And then that is controlling this RGB LED. These things come in strings of 50. And this mess here is 4 strings right now. I'm going to add 2 more to it, just like this. The covers on them are obviously something custom, and they are something that I 3D printed, and I've 3D printed a whole bunch more out of just the cheapest translucent white PLA that I could get. For anybody who's actually curious, there's what it is. And no, I don't remember which mail order joint I got it from. But I've been busy printing, as you can see. I used the last of that spool and printed off as many as I could. I'm hoping there's 200 in here. So, no, 100, I guess. Because there's 50 on this string and 50 on another string that I've started putting the covers onto already. And I'll show you that in a bit. And then I'm just going to make sure that the control box is all good. And just as a refresher, I'll show you what's in here. So we have an old laptop brick power supply there, which is powering this board. We've got 3 buck converters, which are each being powered from there. They're putting out 5 volts each and running it out the connectors here and out the cables to the lights. Then down here we have ESP8266, aka Wemos D1 mini clone. And that is the brains of the operation. And then for the output connectors, I've just used a couple of trailer light connectors because I figure they're designed for outdoors, so why not? And then connected to them, we have 3-pin wiring going to the first string of LEDs, and then some lamp cord running up. So it's a much heavier gauge carrying 2 of those 5-volt supplies up to feed the string in the 1/3 and 2/3 position with extra power, so we don't get, you know, a brownout on the thing. So step one in this seasonal project here is just to power it on and make sure the lights still work. And if I turn off my workbench lights, I think that you can see that they do in fact all still work. And I'm just going to look at the whole bunch of them. And I'll just go through and make sure that they are all still working, but I'm pretty sure they are. So this point here is where the string starts. This is the feed cable coming from the box with DC and control. And I've just scabbed on another one off the side of it running at 90 degrees off. So this light and this light are both the first light in the string, and they're in parallel with each other. So then from there, the data bounces off this direction, off to the rest of the string, to the 150 lights that way. But it also branches off and hits this string and goes 50 lights off that direction as well. So that's what I'm going to do with these new ones. I'm going to go at the 1/3 and 2/3 points, because that's where the DC injection is, and I'm going to branch off there. That way I don't have to, I mean, it's easy to change the programming, but I don't have to run more wire for current down to the far end of the string. I can just use my existing wire here. And this one here, you notice it's just all taped up. That, for the people that were watching last year, is because I actually soldered this branch on outside on the tree while it was, kind of wintry conditions. So here is why I want to redo this. Well, one of the reasons, just I want to do better weatherproofing than tape, but my soldering standing out on the side of the sidewalk buried in the tree was completely and utterly crap. and this ground wire actually fell off as I was disassembling it. So I'm just going to reassemble all this properly, solder it down, and then we can carry on. There, that's much nicer. And then I'll slide up the piece of heat shrink over top of that, and just to keep it a little bit extra weatherproof, I'm going to tuck a couple of bits of hot melt glue, just little slivers of it, inside the heat shrink as I slide that on. And then as I shrink it down, that will sort of encapsulate everything and hopefully keep the water from ingressing. Is that a word, ingressing? Anyway, that's what's happening. That's what I've done previously with the connections on these things, and I haven't had any problem in the 4 years that this stuff's been outside. And yeah, you can buy heat shrink that's got essentially hot melt glue already pre-lining it. That stuff's horrendously expensive, and it tends to only come in the larger sizes, not small stuff like this. And after all that soldering, it still works. That's excellent. So in the interest of procrastination, I am going to do one other thing. I'm going to pluck this D1 Mini out of here, and I'm going to update the software that's on it. Just a minor update, though. Here's the software that's running on it, and if you really care, you can download it from there. I'll put a link down below as well. But this is the original software from several years ago, and I'm going to make a couple of changes to it. Well, one change, really, and that is to change the static IP address that I have set into it. Yeah, you could set it to do DHCP and pull up an automatic one, but I like to know where it is so I can just address it by its IP address. And since my ISP made some changes in the last year, my IP address range at the house here has changed. And yeah, I know I could run my separate router and get them to put it into bypass mode or whatever, so that I can use my router as the gateway and assign addresses, but I don't want to go through all that. So I'm just going to quickly change those addresses in the Arduino IDE and then re-upload it. And I think that's the last of procrastination. Then I'll just get on to putting those lenses on 100 more LEDs. And there we go. It's actually working. This website is being generated off that D1 Mini. And there's a bunch of standard presets that we've programmed in there. We've got a few different patterns, or you can just manually choose whatever colors you want, up to 4 colors, and send it and create your own custom repeating patterns on the thing. It's really quite cool, and I appreciate my kid for programming this thing for me all those years ago. And yes, when you change the presets on it, it does in fact work. Awesome. All right, no more procrastinating. The box is still sealed. That's good. Everything works. Now I just have to get onto putting all of those onto all of these and the other string wherever it is around here. So the method here is to just break off the foot, what is that, brim, I guess, from when I printed them. You kind of need the brim for these things to stand up. You slip a piece of half-inch heat shrink over there and slip that on. I'm going to center it a little bit. You notice on the lights there's these little kind of barb things. These things are intended to be put in from the back of a little metal signboard. So there's a couple little barbs there to grab onto that. So you set it so that the heat shrink is just covering those and coming up a fair bit on there. And then you just shrink it down. And it grabs on fairly tightly. I'm running my heat gun at about 200 Celsius. So it also softens the PLA just a little bit underneath the heat shrink. And heat shrink gets a good grab on it. If you look closely, you can actually see that it's distorted the layer lines a little bit and it's grabbing in there. So that's not going to let go. And that's been proven over several years with the 150 lights that I've had out since I put this thing up in the first place. So I am confident in that. And the other thing that people have wondered is how this PLA is going to hold up outside. Well, I mean, you saw those other bulbs, and I have not yet had one completely fail. So they have discolored ever so slightly, but they are still holding together. They haven't disintegrated or anything. They don't feel any different. So I am completely confident in this method. And if you excuse me, I am just going to do this another, well, this string and then one more string 100 times. I'll get back to you eventually.
2 days later.
Okay, that took approximately forever, but I've got those all on there. So the next step is to splice these into the string. And I know I sort of explained it before, but here's what that's going to look like. So the control box has power and one data line coming out of it. Three power lines, one of them is with the data line, and then two separate power lines. The first one is going to one string of 50 LEDs, and then coming off the side of it is a second string of 50 LEDs. That exists right now. At the end of this first string of LEDs and power, because it's power along with it, right, three wires on there, then we splice onto a second string of 50 LEDs, and one of these power insertions comes in there. So it will be feeding power both back that way and forward that way as it joins in, you know, it splices into that, right? And then, so we go 50 LEDs this way, and then we join into the third string of 50 LEDs, and the last power line goes into that insertion point. So that's what it is right this moment. What I'm going to do is take these two strings of 50 LEDs and attach one there and one there. So they're going to tap off the data at those two points, and they're going to be powered from, you know, the combination of the power that's coming from here and here. Each one of these three power lines is 5 volts regulated at whatever current those little boards are. I can't remember off the top of my head. As I was recording that last little bit, it got me to thinking just how much current can these regulators handle. So these are based on an LM2596. Okay, so that LM2596 is capable of 3 amps. So we should not have any trouble. I've basically got 15 amps at 5 volts available at the three different points that I'm inserting power. So yeah, that should be no problem, even with all these extra LEDs on there. So with that reassurance, I can just get busy preparing the ends of these cables. So on the ends of these, they have a connector, which I just snipped off because I'm soldering it. There's the power ground and data lines there, and there's two extra power and ground lines here. So I'm going to parallel up those power lines. And with that done, it's just a matter of finding where the splices are in the existing cables, cutting into them and tapping off them. This tape here is just to hold everything together. It's not actually doing anything electrical. Out here, the connections are properly heat shrunk. As you can see, and I just have to jump into the middle of them. Where is the, there it is. So this is the first branch off, and there you can see the DC power being added on here. And then, as you can see, there's the control wire and the other power wires coming through. So again, the power wires in here are in parallel with these power wires. So the feed through there and these two boosted power wires coming in are all the same thing. Right, well, it's just soldering at this point, so I'll just get on with it and get back to you, I think, when I'm ready to test it. Right, there's the first three-way join made and all shrink together. That was a bear to get apart because, as I mentioned earlier, I put hot melt glue inside those to seal them up. So cutting them apart to re-solder them was a bit of a pain. But I've got them in there now. Kind of hard to see in the bench lights. If you go down the floor, here is the main line here, you can see, and that clump on the floor is the branch. And there's the rest of them carrying on. So far, so good. Now, just to repeat that one more time with the other string over here. Once I find where in this mess the last join is. So, allow me to struggle and cut this apart again, peel off the tape. Most of this tape is just, like I said, binding the wires together, just mechanically. It's not doing anything electrical. You can see these stripes between every bulb here. That's just purely mechanical. Oh, I did heat shrink those. But I taped this one. Why was I being lazy like that? Oh, I have no excuse. I was just literally being lazy. There. That should be the last heat shrink done. If you're going to do the glue trick inside the heat shrink, you have to linger a little bit longer on there just to let the glue soften, and then the heat shrink will, you know, clamp down on it and squeeze it out, like you can see there and there. So I've got a nice good seal in that. I'm powering the lights on. The new extension works. Looks like the rest of the knot still works. Success! The only thing left to do now is to hang it on the tree and hope that the neighbors appreciate the effort that I've gone to decorate.